Yes, madam. We'll start now. Madam, is it okay? Can we start?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, others?
Yes, just a second. Just a second. We can start.
Right. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for this webinar organized by Karnataka State Physiotherapy Federation. Today's webinar's topic is outcome measures used in cardiopulmonary rehabilitation. Today we have a very eminent speaker with us, Dr. Renuka Devi M. We welcome you, madam.
Thank you, sir.
She is specialized in cardiorespiratory, professor and vice principal, JSS College of Physiotherapy, Mysore. It's an honor to have you with us today, madam, to conduct this webinar. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you,
we also have with us our very own Dr. Adarsh NS, who is the consultant physiotherapist at Sukrutha Ortho Care and Adarsh Physio Care Center, Mysore. So welcome to the webinar, and I'm very glad that you've accepted our to be the moderator for today's session.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be with the team. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Adarsh, you can take over and we can start this session.
Yes, sir. Fine. Thank you. Hello. Okay. Now we'll start the session. I welcome Dr. Renuka Devi M. She's an associate professor and the principal of JSS College of Mysore. I welcome you, ma'am. Let us see that. Can you hear me?
Hello? Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, I can hear you, Adarsh.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Welcome you, ma'am. I'd like to introduce Dr. Renuka M. She's the associate professor and vice principal of the JSS College of Physiotherapy. She has finished her master degree at 2007 and PhD in 2019. So I welcome you, ma'am. And she has specialized in cardiopulmonary. She has been a lecturer from 2008 till 2018. And then associate professor from 15 and associate professor at 2018. So kindly give enlighten the hello.
Hello.
Yes, madam, you can start off. I believe Adarsh has some connectivity issue. We can go on, Adarsh.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
That is an issue. Please take over the ma'am. Let's start session. Today's session is outcome measures used in cardiopulmonary rehabilitation. So we have an eminent professor, associate professor Dr. Renuka Devi M. She will take over. Please carry on, ma'am.
Thank you, Adarsh. Thank you. Good evening, one and all. And first, I would like to thank the Karnataka State Physiotherapy Federation, Karnataka, for arranging this webinar. And I would thank the organizers for giving me a platform to talk about an outcome measures used in cardiopulmonary physiotherapy in this platform. Thank you so much, Karnataka State Physiotherapy Federation. I thank Adarsh and I thank Dr. Sai Mahendra for being here with me for organizing this event this evening. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Adarsh, I'll start, Adarsh.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please, you can tell you, ma'am. You're welcome.
So, good evening, all of you who's there to attend my session today. So what I'm going to speak today is on outcome measures used in cardiopulmonary physiotherapy. And my name is Dr. Renuka Devi. I'm a professor and vice principal of JSS College of Physiotherapy. So introduction, as a physical therapist, we are committed to help our patients achieve the highest level of physical functioning and quality of life through our skilled assessment and interventions. So we use outcome measures to objectify the progress of the treatment and justify services identify areas of the impairment, set attainable and meaningful goals, promote evidence-based practice, and endorse patient-client-centered care. So the objective for the audience today is at the end of the session, you'll be able to select appropriate outcome measures based upon a patient's individual needs, identify precautions and contraindications to administer outcome measures safely in the cardiovascular and pulmonary patient population, demonstrate knowledge differentiating functional and patient self-reported outcome measures, understand the basic premise, method, and supporting evidence for the outcome measures. So first, before that, we should know what is outcome measure. An outcome measure is a tool used to assess a patient's current status. The outcome measures may provide a score, an interpretation of a result, and at times a risk categorization of a patient. So it provides baseline data, which may help determine the course of treatment intervention and also if patient has demonstrated some changes after the intervention. So it provides credible and reliable justifications for treatment on an individual patient level. So under outcome measures, there are different classifications. So there are four types of categories or classifications under outcome measures. One is self-reported measures, and second is performance-based measures. Third one is observer-reported measures, and fourth one is clinician-reported measures. So first is about the self-report measures. So the self-report measures is typically captured in the form of questionnaire. It objectifies a patient's perception. The questionnaire can be either a therapist interviewed the patient or the therapist independently completed the questionnaire. The questionnaire where the patient report on health or physical function. The questionnaire where the patient himself report on health or physical function is known as patient-reported outcome measure. So patient-reported outcome measure can be categorized as disease-specific, or it can be generic. So generic is nothing but applied across different population, and condition-specific is used to assess outcomes that are specific or unique to a particular disease or sectors of care. So patient-reported outcome measures can be defined as a report of a status of a patient's health condition that comes directly from the patient without interpretation of the patient's response by a clinician or anyone else. The second type is a performance-based measure. So this requires the patient to perform a set of movements or a task. The patient will perform a set of movement or task. The score is based on objective measurement or qualitative assessment. So objective assessment is nothing but time taken to complete the task. And qualitative assessment is nothing but normal or abnormal mechanics for a given task that we observe. So this performance-based measures and patient-reported measures both are almost captures the same status, current status. So the performance-based measures tend to bring to light the physiological factors. And patient-reported outcome measures may capture a patient's perception, belief, social factors, and health factors. The third one is the observer-reported measure. So in this, the measurement is based on observation by someone other than the patient or a health professional. So usually done by patient's non-clinical caregiver, family, or anyone living around the patient and observes the patients in daily life. A very good example is assessment of the patient's cognition level. And the fourth type of outcome measure is clinician-reported measure. This reflects the evaluation of the patient's condition by a healthcare professional. This is usually done by the clinicians in day-to-day. So based on the report that comes from a trained healthcare professional of the observation of the patient condition, this is the usual assessment that we do, that is pain rating scale can be a good example. So these are the four types of classification of outcome measure. The next is how to select an outcome measure, a guide to select an outcome measure. Why am I using the outcome measure? First, identifying the impact of the disorder on individual. We should know that what is identifying the impact of, is the scale identifying the impact of a disorder on an individual? Second is establishing a baseline measure from which to monitor changes over time. And third one is evaluating the impact of the intervention. Fourth is evaluating the need of those attending the service. This is the four reasons why usually we have to use the outcome measure. And the next is, what am I aiming to measure? So as a physiotherapist, we should know what we are measuring. So you all know ICF classification domain. There are five domains that under ICF classification: body structure, function, activity limitation, participation, and environment. So as a therapist, when we select any sort of conditions, it can be a community dwelling or it can be a clinical setup, we should know what area are we assessing. So impairments of the body structure and functions, that what we are assessing, or it is an activity limitations, or it is a participation restriction, or it is a quality of life. So we should also know the kinematic properties of a tool being used. Does the study samples have the same condition? Whatever tool we are using, is the tool used in the same populations before? Is the study sample similar in disease severity? Is the study sample similar in disease-specific factors? So these all have to consider in the kinematic properties. Next is psychometric properties. This refers to the validity and reliability of the measuring tool. So any measuring tools that we use, it has to be a good validity and reliability. So excellent psychometric properties means the scale is both reliable and valid after evaluated very extensively. Next is the outcome measure reliable? So do I know the rate of error detected in the scores? There's something known as inter-class correlation coefficient, which is more than 7, which is actually desirable and a good reliable outcome measure. And Spearman-Brown reliability coefficient, which is more than 7, which is desirable. Next is, do I know the minimal detectable change? Minimal detectable change is a small amount of noticeable change which we can say the patient has improved clinically. So this minimal detectable change will assist in determining if the real change has occurred. Minimal detectable change is calculated using the standard error of measure. And we should also know whether the outcome measure is valid. Does it measure what I want to measure? That is very important. So there are, I just like to tell you, there are four types of validity. One is criterion validity, construct validity, concurrent validity, and predictive validity. Criterion validity is that compares a measure to a gold standard of any measurement. And the construct validity is compares a measure to a theoretical framework. And concurrent validity compares how well a measure correlates with the previously validated measures. And predictive validity determines how well a measure will predict a future event or performance. So these are the different types of validity. So whenever we check the scale, we have to see the validity of the tool or the scale that we are using. Is the outcome measure responsive to change? Is there a known minimally clinically important difference? That is nothing but a small amount of, as I told you, a small amount of change in a score that would mandate a change in the patient's management. So in every rehab measures, they should have surely mentioned the responsive index, responsiveness index. It is the ability of a measure to detect minimally clinically important difference after intervention. This minimally clinically important difference may not have documented for all the outcome measures. Few outcome measures, they don't have minimal clinically important measures, but they are their validity and reliability may be good. And therapist implementation. So we should also know, is the measure easy for a clinician to conduct? Is a special training. Whatever the scales and measurements are there, we cannot easily administer. We need a special, sometimes some tools needs an training. So is special training required? Is it available? Are there clear standardized instructions on how to carry out a score is given or not? How long does it take to carry out the measure? And how long does it take to record the results is very, very important. The resources, is a special equipment. Do we need a special equipment or a special forms? Anything is required to implement that tool. Is space sufficient for this measure to be carried out? Has to be accounted. And the client is the one very important. Now we'll have to know how much time does it take for the person to complete this task. Is the task difficult? Is privacy required? So if it's a patient reported outcome measures, what we are using, we'll have to know whether it's a face-to-face contact required. Does the questionnaire cover sensitive personal issues? Is there a specific reading level required? Sometimes the patient will be not... literate level we have to know, because we should know whether the patient will be able to read the tool or the specific questionnaires for him to answer by himself. is a measure available in other languages. So some many questions are in English language, and other in British English or in USA English languages. But we will have to know whether it is changed within regional languages before we implement to the patient. Next is financial consideration. What is the cost of the test? Is a license required? Is equipment required? We'll have to know. So these are the guide which we have to, as a therapy, which we have to use to select an outcome measures. So tips for success. If we select an instrument with a known reliability, validity, and sensitivity and responsiveness, and be familiar with how to score the instrument and understand the clinical meaning of the range of the scores, and administer the measure upon intake, re-evaluation, and discharge. And if we're able to interpret the change in the scores and how those changes will affect the clinical management treatment plan, and if we stay organized with the administration of instrument and tracking outcomes, and utilize outcomes over time to evaluate treatment effectiveness, then we are successful in implementing that particular outcome. So these are the outcome measures, which I'm going to little brief on. So what outcome measures, what I've selected here is a functional capacity under three headings, that is functional capacity measurement, quality of life, and the clinical assessment tools. So this functional capacity measures quality of life and clinical tools, what I've selected here is a very common one, which usually everyone might be using in your setup, particularly who are working under cardiac respiratory setup. I have selected this because these are the scales, or these are the observed type of scales, or performance-based scales, or it is a questionnaire, which is usually easy to do in an R setup, Indian setup, or community setup, without needing any sophisticated equipment space, as I told you. So that's the reason I have taken this simple, this is also reliable and valid outcome tools, which can be easily practiced and which we have to be practiced in the cardiopulmonary setup. So under functional capacity measurements, we have 6-minute walk test, we have a physical performance test, an incremental shuttle walk test, and Duke's activity status index. Under quality of life, I have taken chronic respiratory questionnaire, St. John's respiratory questionnaire, and Minnesota living with heart failure questionnaire. And the clinical assessment tools, most of them are dyspnea. Not only that, we have a New York Heart Association classification also. It's a Vogue scale of positive exertion scale, Modified Medical Research Council, another one is a shortness of breath questionnaire, and baseline dyspnea index and transition dyspnea index, and COPD assessment tool, board index, and New York Heart Association classifications. So these are the outcome measures that I'm briefing the next. So before we go into the measuring the functional capacity, it is nothing but a task which is given to the patient, or any measures that is given to the patient. The patient's performance is what is happening here. So as a therapist, we should consider the patient's safety during functional measurement. So I don't want to briefly I don't want to give a history on a lot of contraindications, but the main absolute contraindications I would like to tell. So they are unstable angina, resting heart rate more than 120 beats per minute, resting systolic pressure more than 180 mmHg, and resting diastolic pressure more than 100 mmHg. So patient exhibiting any of the above symptoms should be referred to the physician, their physician, for a clinical assessment and clearance to participate in the task. So reasons to terminate. As a therapist, we should also know to terminate the exercise testing, even as a field test or as a lab test. So signs and symptoms of significant distress is angina, dyspnea, severe musculoskeletal pain including claudication, confusion, dysarrhythmias, increasing multifocal or coupled preventricular contractions, and ventricular tachycardia, rapid atrial dysarrhythmia, fall in BP more than 20 mmHg on increasing the workload when the workload is increased, extreme hypertensive response where systolic BP is more than 240 mmHg and diastolic BP more than 130 mmHg, ataxic gait, pallor, and diaphoresis. In case of emergency, the testing should be performed in an area where the rapid response is available. So we have to have all first aid equipped when we do one test. Always have a telephone nearby, know the location of the crash cart and other supplies, that is preferably supplemental oxygen. Other than that, sublingual nitro, aspirin, metered-dose inhalers, nebulizers, and glucose monitor has to be kept aside. So test administer, of course, the test administer should be a minimum BLS certified, ALS preferred. And a physician attendance for certain individuals should be provided when necessary. If the patient is on chronic oxygen therapy, oxygen should be always be provided during testing at the patient's standard rate or as directed by the physician. So 6-minute walk test is an objective field test used to measure functional capacity, treatment outcomes, excess tolerance, peak oxygen consumption, and patient prognosis. So these are the five things that we objectively use the 6-minute walk test for. So intent and populations, which population do we use 6-minute walk test and is said to be used is older adults, patients with heart and lung disease, heart-lung transplantation, congestive heart failure, pulmonary hypertension, lung resection, lung volume reduction surgery, COPD, peripheral vascular disease, and cystic fibrosis. So the materials what we need and what's the setup that we need is the material is stopwatch, a 30-meter corridor has two small cones to mark the course of the lane, and one chair, scoring sheet, pen, clipboard, spuma manometer, pulse oximeter monitor, source of oxygen supply, telephone, and AED. Setup is measure the walking course of 30 meters and mark with the cones. Mark each meter so we'll accurately know where the patient is stopping when he ends. Allow the patient to rest in seated positions for 10 minutes prior to the test while gathering pre-test data. Once patient is clear from the participation, obtain baseline dyspnea and fatigue rating in standing, then move to the starting position. So time test, read scripted instructions at the starting point. So what we follow is usually the ATS guidelines or their guidelines for 6-minute walk test. So the read the scripted instructions at the starting point, instruct the patient to begin and start the timer. Scripted encouragement may be, there is a lot of encouragement. This is a self-paced walk test, actually 6-minute walk test. So they need a lot of encouragement for the patient to do this test. So scripted encouragement may be provided during the test at the standardized intervals. The patient may self-select gait speed or variations if he needs, and may take standing or seated rest as and when he needs. So post-test, mark the spot where the patient stopped walking, record post-walk dyspnea and fatigue ratings, which is very important, pulse oximeter and blood pressure. The patient may sit at this time if desired, then calculate total distance ambulated by adding the number of laps to the standard, the additional distance ambulated in the final partial lap that is done. And at last, congratulate the patient for the test completion. So the additional guidelines is choose a quiet place with little distractions and pedestrian traffic, comfortable clothing and secure footwear. Patients may utilize their regular assistive devices if they wanted. They use walkers, let them use the walkers, canes or orthosis, as well as supported oxygen therapy with patient's regular delivery method, that is flow systems if required. Scheduling a practice test, that is 1 hour prior to the real test, may help some patients improve their performance. So be sure to document any medications taken and time for administration prior to 6-minute walk test, like bronchodilators, nitrates, etc. Walking along with the patient is discouraged. The scoring distance scores are recorded in feet or meters, usually meters. Baseline and post-test dyspnea and fatigue ratings are selected by patients from the Vogue scale. So that is very important. Pre and post Vogue scale is very important. So interpretations, it has been widely documented the 6-minute walk test, the patient walked less than 300 meters is indicative of increased morbidity and mortality in patients with heart failure. So repeated measures may provide insights into a patient's progress with functional measures, VO2 max and response to the treatment. So this is a score sheet. Score sheet, this is the ATS score sheet, but this score sheet has been used in different ways, in different style, because if the patients, we need a prognosis, if you want to see the patient 6-minute walk test 1 month or 2 months, we'll have a different forms of 6-minute walk test that can be changed, provided the method is the same what we implement. So of course, all we have to know is the reliability and validity and responsiveness of the stool or the scale or any measures that we use. So the reliability of the 6-minute walk test here is test retest interclass correlation coefficient is 0.96 to 0.99, which is said to be a good reliability. And validity significant correlations where R value is 0.73 between 6-minute walk test and peak oxygen uptake in patients with end-stage lung disease. They have done on end-stage lung disease and they found a significant correlation between 6-minute walk test and oxygen uptake. And significant correlations where R value is 0.64 between 6-minute walk test and VO2 max in patients with advanced heart failure. And concurrent validity is correlates moderately to strongly with other established measures of function and predictive validity of short-term survival in patients with heart failure. Responsiveness, 6-minute walk test has been documented to be more responsive to deterioration than improvement in the heart failure symptoms. So clinically significant difference in of 6-minute walk test is studies examining patients with COPD suggest that an improvement of 70 meters is necessary to demonstrate significant change with 95% confidence in older adults and more than 40 meters in case of COPD. So these are the developments and context information of 6-minute walk test. And the next is physical performance test. So physical performance test is a direct observational field. As I told you, there are 4 types of outcome measures. This comes under the observational field test that is used to measure multiple dimensions of physical functions, basic and complex ADLs, prediction in physical decline, and degrees of motor sensory cognitive impairment affecting the physical function. So these are the different domains that the scale is being assessed. And available in 7-item or 9-item. There are 2 versions, 7-item versions or 9-item versions. So the intended populations, which is usually practiced as older adults, frail and community dwelling, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, degenerative joint disease, and COPD. Patients with pulmonary disease, chronic bronchitis, end-stage lung disease, and lung transplantation. Here, the materials required for this physical performance test is stopwatch, tape measure, table, chair, pen, paper, like kidney beans, bowl, coffee can, book, shelf, jacket, 50 feet corridor, stairs, pulse oximeter, monitor. Setup is assemble materials. Set up each of the 9 items as described in the testing manual. Take baseline vitals to ensure patient safety. And administration time test, actually time each of the 9 items. So the 9 items in this measurement. So this 9 item has to be timed, okay? Given in the testing manual. So we should ask the patient to write a sentence, and we should see how long he will take to write a sentence. And stimulated eating like that, like you lift a book and place it on a shelf, don degrees, 50 feet walk test, climb on flight of stairs, and climb more than 1 flight, up to 4 flights of stairs. Post-test, allow patient to rest in a seated position. Take post-test vitals for patient safety. Determine patient score with times recorded for each task. Concurrent patients after completing the test. So you can choose either it is a 9-point version, 7-point version. It's suitable for the patients, depends upon the patient. And we have to choose a quiet space with little distractions and encourage patient to dress in comfortable clothing. And the subjects are given 2 chances to complete each task if necessary. Assistive devices can be utilized for item 6 and 9. The scoring is each item is timed and the times are then converted into values on a 5-point ordinal scale, that is 0 to 4. The point of each time, each item are summed for a maximum score of 36 on the physical performance test. Scores indicate high level of physical performance. Scores are divided into categories for the interpretations. So, for example, if the patient scores 32 to 36, he's not frail, he's independent. This is usually used for older adults. And 25 to 32, it's mildly frailty. And 17 to 24, it's moderate frailty. And more than 17, frail, not likely to function in the community. A score of less than 15 on the physical performance test under the category of 7 items has been reported to be predictive of fall. He's prone to fall. So these are the PPT physical performance test score sheet. These are the domains which is present. This write a sentence, stimulated eating. So this is the scoring which is given here. Less than 10 seconds, 10.5 to 15 seconds, 15.5 to 20 seconds. and more than 20 seconds. Sorry, it's too small to look into. So these are the courses. It is available freely. You can easily download that and use that. And physical performance test, this reliability, of course, the test and retest reliability by inter-class correlation coefficient is 0.88 to 0.96, and inter-rater is 0.99. Validity, concurrent validity, the physical performance test has been highly correlated. The R value is 0.5 to 0.8 with basic activities of daily living scale and Hill and Trinity gait scale. The R value is 0.5 to 0.8. Constant validity is moderately correlated, where the R value is 0.24 to 0.47, which states the mental health. And predictive validity for false with sensitivity is 75% and specificity is 71%. Responsiveness, response to measuring both patient improvement and decline, and clinical significant differences, change in the score of 2.4 points is required to demonstrate a clinically significant improvement. Next is incremental shuttle walk test. So incremental shuttle walk test is a little sophisticated than the two tests that I told you, that is 6-minute walk test and physical performance test, because this we need in CD, which is said to be a standard way of measuring it. The Hello, am I audible? Can you all hear me? So next is incremental shuttle walk test. This is a field walking test to assess functional capacity in patients with chronic airway obstruction. It's a symptom limited exercise test. So this is an 10-meter, this needs a 10-meter walkway, and this is the protocol, which is set in different levels, at 12 levels. And number, the speed which is set, and the number of shuttles per level, and the distance that they have, the person has to complete for each lap. Yes, this is the protocol. And here the patient walks between two cones in a time to set of auditory beeps played on a CD. Initially, the walking speed is very slow, but each minute the required walking speed progressively increases. The patient walks as long as they can until they are either too breathless or can no longer keep up with the beeps which at each time ends in the 10 meters cone. The number of shuttles laps between the cones is recorded. The incremental shuttle walks must be measured on two occasions to account for a learning effect. The best result is recorded. If the repeat test is performed on the same day, 30 minutes rest should be allowed between tests. Only standardized instructions for the CD should be used. Standardized instruction from the CD should be used. In contrast to the 6-minute walk test, no encouragement should be given throughout the walk test. Comfortable ambient temperature and humidity should be maintained for all tests. Health professional trained in CPR, that is, as I told you, BLS certified expert, is to run this test. So before implementing the incremental shuttle walk test, medical history, precautions, or contraindication to exercise testing has to be done. Instruct the patient to dress comfortably and wear appropriate footwear. Any prescribed inhaled bronchodilators should be assessed and taken care. Patient should rest for at least 15 minutes before beginning the incremental shuttle walk to record the pre-test data, that is blood pressure, heart rate, oxygen saturation, dyspnea score. And the patient should be get familiarized with the dyspnea rate of Boak scale, because he should rate where is he, which is the point that he is perceiving his exertion. At the end of the incremental shuttle walk test, the patient is more than 0.5 meter away from the cone. When the beep sounds, then we'll have to stop the or end the shuttle walk. The patient reports that they are too breathless to continue, or the patient reaches 85% of the predicted maximal heart rate, that is using this formula 210 minus 0.65 into age, the patient exhibits any of the following signs. Then the test has to be terminated. The symptom is chest pain that is suspicious of for angina, evolving mental confusions or lack of coordination, evolving lightheadedness, intolerable dyspnea, leg cramps or extreme leg muscle fatigue, persistent SpO2 to less than 85%, any other clinically warranted reasons. So see the patient, once the test is over, see the patient, or if the patient prefers, allow the patient to stand. The measurement taken before and after the test should be taken with the patient in the same position. If it's done prior in the standing, it should be in the standing position. If it's sitting, it should be in the sitting position. Immediately record oxygen saturation, heart rate, and dyspnea rating. 2 minutes later, record SpO2 and heart rate to assess the recovery rate. Record the total number of shuttles. Record the reason for terminating the test. That's very important. And the patient should remain in a clinical area for at least 15 minutes following the uncompleted, uncomplicated test. So the incremental shuttle walk responsiveness, reliability, and validity. The test does not reflect common daily activities that require endurance and spacing, because this shuttle walk is endurance test where it really doesn't reflect the daily activities. The incremental shuttle walk was shown to be responsive to pulmonary rehabilitation and bronchodilator administration. It's well documented. For criterion validity, a comparison between distance covered during incremental shuttle walk and peak oxygen consumption reported correlations, which is ranging from 0.67 to 0.95, and intra-class correlation coefficient for test-retest reliability range from 0.76 to 0.99. So it has a good criterion validity and intra-class correlation coefficient for test and retest. The minimally clinically important difference in patients with COPD was 48 meters in shuttle walk. Predictive equations for the distance and shuttle walk are available for healthy individuals. It is there. The next functional measurement is Duke's Activity Status Index. It's usually used for the cardiac patients. So this is self-administered, and it's a 12-item questionnaire that has been shown to accurately estimate true maximal capacity in a metabolic equivalence. The raw mean score was utilized to assist with risk stratification and excess prescription for individual participants. So this has a criterion, the criterion related validity is supported by significant difference of Duke's activity status index scores of for each New York Heart Association classifications. So there is a correlation between these two indexes. And constant validity was supported by significant correlation of Duke's activity status index score with health related quality of life with the R value of minus 0.64, and depressive symptoms were R value of 0.44. So these are the functional assessment that I spoke. And next is the quality of life. There are three quality of life questionnaires that I give an introduction on. The first is Minister of Life, Living with Heart Failure questionnaire. So the background of this is actually, it's one which is measuring the quality of life especially for the patients with heart failure. So the components or the domains which is the questionnaire has is physical status, emotional well-being, socioeconomic factors, and psychological factors. So 21 items, self-administered instrument. And so it's a self-reported measure. It's one of the type of outcome measures that I spoke before. And summary score is physical impairment score and emotional impairment. It has both physical and emotional impairment. So as I told, the intended population is patients with heart failure. And administration materials, we needed paper, pen or pencil, table and chair. Setup is assemble materials, ensure patient has adequate cognition and reading comprehension to complete the instrument. Next is the patient self-administers 21-item questionnaire. On average, requires 20 to 15 minutes to complete this questionnaire. Post-test, collect the instrument from the patient for scoring and congratulate the patient on instrument completion. The scoring is... It is a 21-item score. It's a 21-item score on a 6-point Likert scale, that is 0 to 5. 0 point indicating none and 1 point indicating very light and 5 point very much. So this is a 6-point Likert scale which is used. And patient rating for each items was summed into three categories, scoring categories. Overall score is 0 to 105 possible points. Physical score is different and emotional score is different. And physical subscores are drawn from set of 8 items and emotional score is drawn from set of 5 items. So this is, sorry again, you cannot see that properly. So this is also easily available and you can easily download from the, even for the rehab measures database. So scoring and interpretations, lower scores indicate better health-related quality of life, while higher scores are indicative of worse health-related quality of life. The scoring ranges lesser than 24 is good health-related quality of life, and 24 to 45 score is moderate health-related quality of life, and more than 45 is poor health-related quality of life. So reliability, test retest reliability, that's the interclass correlation coefficient is 0.99, which is said to be good reliability, and validity, concurrent validity, it has a good concurrent validity with when it is correlated with the heart failure questionnaire, functional status scale, SF-12, health-related quality of life, and with scores with NIA, New York Heart Association functional classes. So the minimal detectable change, so change in the score must be more than 2.77 into the standard error of measurement to be 95% confident. And responsive to change has demonstrated responsive to change in multiple RCTs examining a variety of clinical interventions. It's using many clinical interventions, particularly patients with cardiac diseases. So significant, clinically significant difference, multiple trials have suggested a change in the score of 5 points is required to demonstrate a clinically significant change in the patient status. So this is about the Ministova heart failure questionnaire. The next is, you all must be knowing about the chronic respiratory disease questionnaire and St. George respiratory questionnaire that I'm going to speak on. So chronic respiratory disease questionnaire is widely used and it is a good, reliable and valid questionnaire. So it is a commonly used as a disease-specific tool. It is a disease-specific tool to evaluate the health-related quality of life in patients with chronic respiratory disease, especially COPD. Or any other cardiac, other chronic respiratory disease also. So they have used in ILDs also. So it's a 20-item scale. Interviewer administered instrument that examines patient's perception across. It is going to examine the patient's perception on the disease, on the symptoms, on the impact of the disease on him. So there are 4 domains: dyspnea, fatigue, emotion function, and mastery. The patient with chronic respiratory disease is usually who's having a chronic disease more than 3 months and other diseases that lead to chronic airflow limitations, that is COPD. So emphysema, chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, restrictive lung disease, pulmonary fibrosis, lung cancer, scleroderma, and GVHD. So reliability, test retest is again 0.92, 0.93. And interclass correlation coefficient and validity, concurrent validity is with St. John respiratory questionnaire and breathing problem questionnaire, where the R value is 0.72 to 0.88 and breathing problem questionnaire along with the, breathing problem questionnaire, the R value was 0.75, which is said to be a valid. And a minimal detectable change is unreported. We don't know what is the minimal detectable change. responsive to change, chronic respiratory questionnaire consistently shown to be one of the most responsive instrument in measuring and detecting change in the pulmonary health-related quality of life. And a significant clinical significant difference, they say that more than 2 points per domain. That is overall score. There are 4 domains which I mentioned. So each under each domain, there should be 2 points change. Then it's said to be a clinically significant difference. So materials required is a paper, pen or pencil, table, 2 chairs, and setup is assembled materials. Select a private space to minimize distraction and promote patient confidentiality. Test posters. Test interviewer guides patient through 4 domains, that is dyspnea, 5 questions individualized, fatigue, emotional functions, and mastery. So dyspnea, there are 5 questions, and fatigue, 4 questions, emotional function, 7 questions, and mastery, 4 questions. The instruments take probably 20 minutes to complete. Post-test, congratulate the patient once he completes it, and some items in each of 4 domains for the scoring purpose. So each of the 4 domains contain 4 to 7 items. So dyspnea, 35 points, fatigue, 28 points, emotional function, 49 points, and mastery, 28 points. Each item is graded by the patient on 7-point Likert scale, 1 to 7. 1 point indicates maximum impairment, and 7 points indicates no impairment. The 4 domain score remains separate to reflect patient status in 4 specific area. Interpretation, higher scores indicate better quality of life, while the lower scores indicate worse health-related quality of life. So these are the developers and contact information for the scale. The next is St. George Respiratory Questionnaire. The St. George Respiratory Questionnaire was developed to measure health status in patients with respiratory disease, example COPD or asthma. So this there is a modified scale which is there in St. George Respiratory Questionnaire, which is said to be St. George Respiratory C, which is said to be a COPD specific. That also can be used. So domains include here is symptoms, there's frequency and severity of respiratory symptoms, activity, effects on the adjustment of the everyday activities, and psychosocial impact. These are the 3 domains which is documented here. So it's widely used in clinical trials as a secondary endpoint, assesses effects of treatment, management, and intervention of health status in chronic lung disease. Section 1, symptoms. So they have used 5-point Likert scale to rate the symptom. And section 2 is activity, and 3 is impact. This is an SR-no type of answering questions. And each time, each item weighed based on empirical data, and the score ranges 0 to 10, 0 to 100, highest scores for health, and it is self-administered questionnaire. There is significant, next is sensitivity, reliability, and validity. There is significant correlation between St. George Respiratory Questionnaire and FEV1-FEC, resting saturation of oxygen, 6-minute walk distance, Medical Research Council dyspnea index, and anxiety score and depression scores. A reliable and valid in COPD, asthma. It's a we have also, as I told you, there's a COPD specific version, which is also there, which is said to be a SJRQ-C. So the MID is minimal important difference. The minimal important difference of 4 points is applied most often. So efficacy of the treatment has been considered slight with a mean change of 4 points. Moderate mean point of 4, slight improvement is change in the 4 points. If it's a moderate, then there should be a change in the 8 units. And if it is very efficacious, if the intervention is very efficacious, we can expect a change in the unit up to 12 units. So these are the questions which is there. It is easily available and can download, and it is not paid. It did not need any training for implementing SGR. So these are all the quality of life measures that I've spoke. That is Minnesota Heart Failure Questionnaire and Chronic Respiratory Disease Questionnaire and St. George Respiratory Questionnaire. The next is Clinical Assessment Tool. As I told you, this is an observation, a clinician assessment tool which the clinician observes from the patient and classify the patient or grade the patient. So those are known as clinical assessment tools. The first and foremost, which widely uses Modified Medical Research Council scale. So grade, there are 4 or 5 grades. Start from 0. 0 is I only get breathless when strenuous exercise. 1 is I get short of breath when hurrying on a level or walking up a slight hill. So like that, we have a 4 scales to ask the patient's level of breathlessness. This is just we ask the patient what is this level of exertion, and then we record it. This also can be used as one of the outcome measure, but the changes of this measure is very rare, and the minimal clinically important difference also is not yet established. The patient selects a grade on 5-point scale and then describes everyday situations or activities level provoking breathlessness and impairment. The scale requires recall. The patient has to recall the activities, and when we ask, he has to recall the activities and recall when he gets the dyspnea, and then have to be recorded. The scale uses a simple and standardized method of categorizing disability in COPD and stratify interventions upon rehabilitation. It has been in use for over more than 50 years, and it's a public domain. So sensitivity, reliability, and validity. There is a possible underestimation bias due to avoidance of exertion. This chance of the patient may not be able to tell the real exertion level and during and which activities is having the exertion. The tool lacks precise limits and may have low sensitivity to change from intervention. So there's a relatively scarce, less clinical data on validation, responsiveness, and sensitivity, where the R value is -0.53 with other dyspnea measures and 0.42 with FEV1. So the minimal clinical important difference, as I told you, is not being established. This is all about the modified Medical Research Council tool. And next is a scale. And next is modified Bok scale. So Bok scale, I think everyone must be knowing and must be implementing this Bok scale whenever you had given any task or any exercise to the patient to know what is the exertion level the person is perceiving. The Bok scale is a psychophysical measure. Subjects report symptoms associated with the current physical activities, example exercise. The Bok scale rates dyspnea on a scale of 0 to 10 to quantify the intensity of dyspnea, breathlessness, and muscle fatigue during activity. 0 to 10 scale is a modified Bok scale. The original perceived exertion scale was 4 from 6 to 10. That's an old scale, which is usually 6 to 20, but the modified Bok scale is from 0 to 10. So this is a modified Bok scale where it's ranging from 0 to 10, from no breathlessness to maximal breathlessness or exertion. So whenever we give training, we have to see to that the patient training level is at 3 and 4, which is said to be moderate training to somewhat severe zone. So intended population, it is intended for all patients under rehabilitation and for monitoring exercise prescription. Even in athletes, they use exertion, Bok scale of positive exertion. And it may not be suitable for children use as the scoring is difficult to interpret in this age group. Reliability, testing of subjects twice as was used in ascertaining the reliability. So Bok's rate, this scale was found to be reliable in rating exertion. Validity, originally rate of perceived exertion was validated against heart rate. So rate of perceived exertion has been researched extensively in a variety of different conditions and population groups. The recent study reported that Bok's scale may be used in individuals with Parkinson's disease also, in which formal exercise testings may not be available. Responsiveness, a work done in a laboratory setting. There was a relationship observed between perceived physical exertion and individual physical capacity in both cardiovascular and muscular work. Comparison was physiological measurement and actual lifting task in the workplace. There was a correlation. So these are the clinical assessment tools that was modified Medical Research Council and Bok scale. The next is actually University of California, San Diego, shortness of breath questionnaire. So this is also in dyspnea index or a dyspnea scale, which measures the patient's dyspnea level. This rates the ADL rate of dyspnea in 24 activities on 6-point scale. So this include 21 ADLs, range 0 to 20, 120. Higher score is greater breathlessness and lesser score is less breathlessness. So when rates the shortness of breath, when I do or if I were to do the following task, I would rate my shortness breath as 0 to 5. 0 is no breathlessness and 5 is maximal and unable to go further because of shortness of breath. So this is the score of University of California, San Diego and shortness breath questionnaire. Using a Likert scale of 0 to 5, we'll have to score the grade. And the sensitivity, reliability, and validity, and MIDS, the tool is sensitive to various intervention, including bronchodilator. There's a high level of reliability and validity among dyspnea measures. There's a high level of reliability and validity among dyspnea measures. Where 6-minute walk test, when the correlation is done with 6-minute walk test, the R value was -0.240. When it is correlated with the DLC wall, that's a diffusion loss, R value was -0.67. The inter-rater reliability was R value is equal to 0.83. So there's a good correlation. So there's a good reliability and validity. And MID, minimally clinically important difference, is 5 points. The difference in 5 points is said to be in the intervention has been effective. So there is another dyspnea scale that is also extensively used in the clinical settings. That is baseline dyspnea index and transitional dyspnea index. The tool has a baseline and transition in dyspnea ratings. The scale rates according to the functional impairment, magnitude of the task, and the magnitude of the effort. So the baseline dyspnea index it rates the severity of dyspnea at single point in time. It rates dyspnea on 5-point scale. 0 is severe and 4 is unimpaired. And the baseline dyspnea index ranges from 1 to 12. So transition in dyspnea index assesses changes from baseline dyspnea. It is used a 7-point scale from -3 major deterioration to +3 major improvement. Sensitivity, validity, and reliability. The BDI, that is baseline dyspnea index, significantly correlates with the dyspnea diary, which is usually given to the patient to mark the dyspnea level, the number of dyspnea the patient is getting in a week time or in a month time. Score and symptom and activity components of SGRQ also. The transition dyspnea index also correlates with the changes in the dyspnea diary given to the patient, SGRQ, symptom, and activity scores. The construct validity has been established by the association between the baseline FEV1, BDI, and FEV1, and transition dyspnea index. The MID is minimal clinically important difference. One unit has been described as minimally important difference. Change even in the one unit in the scale said to be the patient has a clinically significant improvement after the intervention. So this is the scale which is said to be a baseline functional impairment, baseline dyspnea index scale. This is checking the functional impairment. This is assessing the magnitude of the task and magnitude of the effort. And the next tool, which is assessing the patient's clinically, is a COPD assessment tool. This is known as CATS tool. You can also call it as a CATS tool. It is a simple tool to measure the COPD health status and quantify the impact of COPD of one's life and how this changes occur over time. So the CAT score or COPD assessment test is simple to administer. It aids the clinician in identifying where COPD affects the patient health and daily life the most. Score and impact level. The CAT has a scoring range of 0 to 40. 30, more than 30 is very high. More than 20 is high. 10 to 20 is medium and less than 10 is low. So translations are available at this site, www.cattestline.org, and it is a public domain. So this is a CAT test. This is a Likert scale, which is used from 0 to 5. And these are the different domains, which is asked to the patient, and the patient will mark, and the score has to be given. Sensitivity, reliability, and validity. Evaluation has found that CAT to have similar discriminative properties like SGRQ. St. John Respiratory Questionnaire. The minimally important difference is the difference or change of 2 or more units over 2 or 3 months in a patient, such as a clinically difference. That is, there should be a difference in two units over the time of 2 to 3 months. When there is a 2 units change in 2 months of duration, then we suggest the patient has improved with the interventions which is given. It can be a bronchodilator, it can be a pulmonary rehabilitation post. Next clinical assessment tool is board index. Board index is said to be it's a mortality index, which is used to assess therapeutic efficacy in interventional studies investigating effect of lung volume reduction surgery, pulmonary rehabilitation, and physical training. It's a predictive outcome measure. It provides better power than that of individual components. because there are four components which is here in both walk scale as FEV1, 6-minute walk distance, MMRC and BMI. So each has its own measurement as in each has its own validity and reliability. So when all these measurements are together put up and there is a score which is given, which is from 0 to 10. So this is a much reliable way of predicting the patient's mortality level. So the sensitive reliability and validity, the board sensitivity to change relies heavily on the change in the exercise capacity. So the reliable change is much seen in the 6-minute walk test than MMRC grade, FEV1 or BMI. The MID has not has been, it's still not been established or defined. So the last one is New York Heart Association classification. So you all must be knowing about this classification, which we'll be doing on a daily basis to the patients who are working under a cardiac setup. The New York Heart Association functional classification system was developed to evaluate the effect of cardiac symptoms on a patient's daily activities. Over time, the role of New York Heart Association classification system has expanded and now frequently being used in the clinical research. So I've done with the clinical assessment tools. So take home message, when choosing an outcome measure, it is important to first examine the evidence in order to determine which instrument is most appropriate for your individual patient and what are you trying to measure. And second is always take appropriate safety precautions when implementing functional measures in cardiovascular and pulmonary patient population. Understanding the outcome and using appropriate tool measuring the outcome plays very important role. Many of the cardiovascular and pulmonary outcome measures explained may be implemented efficiently and with the common items found in the clinic. References. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. Does any participant have any questions?
I'm not able to hear you, Adarsh.
Hello. Now, ma'am? Are you able to hear?
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, Adarsh.
Thank you. Thank you for the wonderful session, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Is there any participant has any question over there?
Okay, Adarsh, I think we have a question here in the chat box and question and answer box. Can you just read it out, please? Okay, I think I'll read it out. Ma'am, there's a question from Mr. Armugam. He asks, what outcome measures can be used in post-cardiac surgery patients?
Post-cardiac surgery patients, it depends upon what domain is he want to check. As I told you, there are different domains under ICF also and different domains which I've spoken under different outcome measures. So if we really want to check the function, or it is an activity, or it is an quality of life. So if it is a quality of life, well and good, we can use the Minnesota heart failure question that I've given. Well, and if it is an activity level, it can be any activities that under functional capacity that we spoke. Even 6-minute walk test also is indicated in the post-cardiac surgeries. So the domain is very important. Which domain is he want? Interested in checking is very important. That is only that domain can be addressed only after assessing the patient. After assessing the patient, we'll know what we have to assess. It's an activity or a body function, or it is an quality of life, or his participation to the social.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hope you answer.
Adarsh, Shoyan, can you ask the second question, please? Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, Adarsh, you can ask the second question, please.
Madam, can you just tell me this CABG, after CABG, which is the most reliable test to use it?
Hello, I think I told you now. The same question which was asked now.
Yes, that question's been answered, sir. So we can go ahead with the second question, madam. Dr. Chandra here asks, can you please elaborate on content validity and its importance in cross-cultural adaptation? And what are the barriers of implementation of outcome measures in clinical setup in India?
Sir, actually, as I mentioned, what's the question?
Can you please elaborate on content validity and its importance in cross-cultural adaptation? And what are the barriers of implementation of outcome measures in clinical setup in India?
Actually, when it comes to content validity, as I told you, if there is any questionnaire or any scales which is be used to our setup, even the language may be English, but that may not be in real Indian English. So that has to be seen whether it can, the same scale can be used, because the understanding of the same person will be different for us. So that has to be checked. And same when I told you where there is a language difference. If, for example, we need a translation to a regional language before we implement it. So we have a big process of translation of the questionnaire or the skills to that particular language. Then only we can use that. So we have a lot of barriers, but still that barriers can be changed if we start to implement that.
Right. Thank you, madam. Adarsh, are you there? I'm not able to see if you're there, Adarsh. Okay, right. I think I want to take over when I'm not able to get his network, I believe. Right. So the next question is that, madam, from a participant who asks which age the 6-minute walk test can be done. Is it suitable for any pediatric population?
So 6-minute walk test for pediatric population is they have it is not the reliability and validity is not done, and they have tried the 6-minute walk test for the children's at age of 13 to, I'm not very sure about it, but it has not been practiced for 6-minute walk test for children's.
Yes, madam. Thank you very much. We have a participant who would like to talk to you, Mr. Arnal Rajan. Can you please ask the question, sir? Can we unmute Arnal Rajan, please?
Just a minute.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Arnal Rajan.
Okay. Hello, Dr. Renuka. So I'm Arnal Rajan. So
I have
questions for you. So first one is, you have quoted so many outcome measures. So, but as of now, the COVID situation is going on. Especially the 6-minute walk test and the shuttle walk test, those things. So is it really applicable to use these tests in this COVID situation? Because as of now, all the outpatients have been closed. So face-to-face clinics are not running as of now. So will you give an alternate measuring the functional capacity without seeing a patient?
Okay. So that's a nice question, sir. Actually, what we are implementing in our setup is actually, as the patient not able to visit us as an outpatient, you all know that it's not that easy for a pulmonary patient to give a regular visits also. We know where pulmonary rehabilitation, cardiac rehabilitation lies as an outpatient. Here, what happens is we are started with a tele-rehab. Tele-rehab is what we do. So whenever the patient gets admitted and discharged, we educate the patient about using tele-rehab. So particularly the patients who use the Android phone, we ask if they are willing to do a tele-rehab. So in tele-rehab, what we do is some patients, they come straight away to for exercise training. Some patients, they need only the handouts for the exercise training. So what here we do is we send an information. We educate about using the Bourke scale of perceived exertion, particularly for the patient. That's the only way that we can assess the patient exertion level. For example, the patient was walking here on base of 6 minute walk test that you know very well. So we use 6 minute walk test. On base of 6 minute walk test, we prescribe walking distance for a patient within given time. For example, in 20 minutes, he has to complete 1.5 kilometers and things like that. So when the patient did that in the hospital, his perceived exertion was what we record. For example, his perceived exertion was at more than 7 or 6. So we note it. So, but we always ask the patient to train at 3 and 5, but we will know what was the exertion level for the same activity. So when we call him or when we tell him, ask him what is his exertion level when he walked after a week. So it may change. So the exertion level may become 4 from 6 to 7. So that is the way that we come to know that the patient is improving in the exertion level. That is what we are practically practicing in a tele-rehab. It's a tele-rehab. So I think...
My question was, we are doing a functional capacity assessment in an old patient, but in an home-based, we cannot do a functional capacity assessment.
Yeah.
So instead of doing a functional capacity assessment, the subjective examination, what kind of a subjective examination will tell you or will help you to prescribe an exercise for a particular patient? Will the Bourke scale will be that much reliable to prescribe a exercise for a patient? Because
yes, sir.
Because we don't know how accurate the patient is going to read his Bourke scale. So will that be that much reliable to make an exercise prescription?
That is what when I spoke about that Bourke scale, I told you, sir, that exertion level, the patient may not be able to document their exertion level properly. In both in case of MMRC grading as well as in the Bourke scale, this is a problem. So they have to understand the scale is what we are have to. And we are there are many patients who have less understood about it. And we have a lot of, effort in making them understand the rate of, because rate of positive exertion scale is an extensively used scale for COPD, particularly COPD or any respiratory diseases in that case. So I think we'll have to rely on one of the good outcome measures, as you said, the setup in this setup is using a Bourke scale without any doubt.
Okay, thank you. My second question, what kind of outcome measures will be used for a community-based cardiac or pulmonary rehabilitation?
Cardiac and pulmonary rehabilitation as a community, again, it depends upon what is the domain that we are looking into, Arnold. Like, what is the domain that you want to check? Do you want to check his quality of life or do you want to check his functional capacity? It goes on that. So after your assessment, you will come to know what you have to check in the patient. If it is in functional capacity, well, this is fine. Or if at all, quality of life that you want to check, any questionnaires. I have mentioned only very few, as I told you, I have mentioned only very few questionnaires. In my slides, I said you that it is a very common one without any sophisticated, equipments. Which has to be practiced is this thing. So what I have mentioned here is minister a heart failure question, which is commonly usually practiced. It's a quality of life of any cardiac condition.
Okay, ma'am.
It depends on what domain you check.
Okay, my final question.
Sorry to intervene. There is another participant. He has a question. So let us everybody get a chance. Mr. Argum, can you have your own question? Hello, Mr. Argum? Armugam?
Hello, can you hear, sir?
Yeah. Please go ahead with the question.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Ma'am.
I have two questions, ma'am. First two questions. If the patient's coming to the pulmonary rehab, I can do the 6 minute walk test. Immediately, low resource setting, or if I have the treadmill, what are the immediate rehab I have to start, ma'am? If the once the patient will be if I make to the patient coming to the pulmonary rehab, I did a 6-minute walk test, I can find out for around 500 steps or meters per 6 minutes they walk. So the what are the immediate for a treadmill or whatever the rehab I can start, ma'am? First question, that one, ma'am. And
okay. Shall I answer this question?
Yes, miss, ma'am.
Yeah. Fine. Now, when this is for any patients you're asking, isn't it? It can be a cardiac or pulmonary patient.
But it was mainly for pulmonary rehab, ma'am. Pulmonary rehab.
Yeah. Pulmonary rehab. 6-minute walk test we do for the patients who's having breathlessness. And before we do 6-minute walk test, we always the grade of the patient, where he lies. Grades is we use a gold standard for checking the FEV1. What is the FEV1 level? And we grade the patient. Who needs this 6-minute walk test is usually, I don't say that only grade 4 or grade 3 needs exercise testing. Even grade 1, when he's having acute exacerbation, he's having breathlessness. So all the 4 grades can test. So after doing a 6-minute walk test, you know that we ask symptom pre and post. If the patient is walking for 6-minute walk test and post test, we'll ask the patient's symptoms. If he says that he's more than his dyspnea level of Bok scale is is increased, he could say that the Bok scale on the muscle is increased. So Bok scale we use here in two places. One is for dyspnea level exertion generally, if the breathlessness is involved. Another one. For example, the patient may stop the exercise or end of the exercise, he may say he had a severe leg pain. Okay. So that is if it's a patient's skeletal muscle dysfunction is predominant. Okay. Second is the distance. The patient's walk, that is the main important thing, is the distance. As I mentioned, the 6-minute walk test, when the patient is walking less than 300 meters, that shows the patient's mortality level is prediction of mortality, that is up to 4 years the interpretation of mortality, I think. So the patient level can be easily assessed when the patient walks less than 300 meters. So patients who are walking less than 300 meters are said to be the real indications for pulmonary rehabilitation.
Okay.
Doing a 6-minute walk test, we will have you have a formula to calculate by the distance walked to train the patients on a treadmill or walking or a cycling. So if you want, you can share the email with me. I will send you how to use that calculation to prescribe exercise to train the patient on the treadmill or walking or cycling. I can share that.
Okay. Thank you. Ma'am, one more question is there.
Yeah.
Ma'am, if suppose the patient from that IP, that is inpatient for discharge for pulmonary medicine, how I can facilitate to make the patient to come to the pulmonary rehabilitation program for in OPD basis, ma'am? Not in home based, in the OPD basis.
This is a real the practical problem that you're asking, which everyone are trying for. People particularly under cardiopulmonary are trying.
Yes.
Patient, when the patient is discharging, and you know that pulmonary rehabilitation or exercise intervention is recent evidence is even when the patient soon after the acute exacerbation is fine, settled. And the phase one, when the patient is in the hospital only, we can start pulmonary, exercise training. That is a recent evidence. So the patient has to undergo recurrent education, everyday education about breathlessness management and exercise importance of exercise training. And not only that, the patient has to be brought to the OPD, outpatient department, where we really train the patient and see that, and you have to introduce other patients who are undergoing the treatment. That's the usual thing that we have to do. We are set to do. So when this is done regularly, So most of the patients, what I have seen, the adherence to the pulmonary rehabilitation, there are many factors. It's just not only the understanding, the patient may understand, but there are other external factors which is just the phase two rehabilitation, which has to be addressed. That is not in only me and your problem, that can be general social restrictions, which is not letting them. So I think you'll have to have a education, and rehabilitating the physicians is very important. So whenever the patient had come to visit the physician, make a point they visit the physiotherapist also, So we'll have to make a team. So 100% we have to have, even if you treat one patient a month, we have to have a cardiac rehabilitation team and a pulmonary rehabilitation team working close in a hospital. That would, I think, it would facilitate, that team would facilitate them to adhere to the program, is my.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And there are many other queries. So can you share, please share your email ID so that some of them participants can contact you.
I know that.
So it's all.
Yeah. Shall I share this in the chat itself? Or?
Yeah, you can say it on, I think if you hear it, it would be good.
I'm doing that.
Business mail ID.
I've done that.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Renukaramaya01@gmail.com.
Yeah.
Thank you. It was a well and very good session. Thanks for this session, ma'am. And it was a very informative. And thanks for making the time for this. And it was a really good session. I hope everybody enjoyed it. And we had many lost knowledge. So once again, I thank you with all your busy schedule as a associate professor. You are being here to take a session. Heartfully, once again, I'm congratulating and thanking you. And I will turn over to the Dr. Mahendra. Please, can I take over, sir?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Adarsh. It was wonderful having you as a moderator for today's session. You've been nice asking, I'm sure, it's a long session, and I'm sure people want to learn more from out of it, and they had a lot of questions. But anyways, time constraints are there, and we have to close things, right? So thank you very much for being a wonderful moderator. Thank you, Adarsh. Madam, it's been a wonderful session, very insightful, and I'm sure people would love to hear from you more and more. And
thank you so much.
There are a lot of questions coming in from Facebook, from participants here, but unfortunately the time is short, and we need to move on. So I'm sure they will flood you with questions on your email ID that you've shared. So it's an honor to have you, and thank you so much for being a part of Karnataka State Physiotherapy Federation.
Thank you so much, my side also. I thank Karnataka State Physiotherapy Federation, Karnataka. Thank you so much for giving me this platform to do it. Thank you, Mr. Dr. Mahendra and Adarsh. And thank you all the organizing people who are there behind this event. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. Good day. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.